Hello listeners, I Avantika welcome you to Ensemble Daily News Analysis. Our today's topics for discussion will be driverless cars, psychological autopsy and the Northern River Terrapin. Let's start with driverless cars. An autonomous car, a driverless car or a self-driving car or a robotic car is a vehicle that is capable of sensing its environment and navigating without human input. Autonomous cars use a variety of techniques to detect their surroundings such as radar, laser light, GPS, odometry and computer vision. Promising trials for automated version of the car took place in the 1950s. The first self-sufficient and truly autonomous cars appeared in the 1980s with Carnegie Mellon University and ALV project in 1987. In 1995, the CMU's NavLab 5 completed its first autonomous long-distance driving in the USA. In 2015, the US allowed the testing of fully autonomous cars on public roads. Various self-driving technologies have been developed by Google, Uber, Tesla, Apple, and other major automakers. There are various technologies invested in such cars. The cars maintain a highly accurate internal map of the surroundings based on a wide array of sensors like radar. Software then processes those inputs, plots a path, and sends instructions to the vehicle actuators which control acceleration, braking, and steering. Hard-coded rules, obstacle avoidance algorithms, predictive modeling, and smart object discrimination help the software follow traffic rules. On board there is at least one engineer who will be checking whether all the systems are working correctly or not. While all the current autonomous vehicles must have a manual override button so that the engineer can take control all the time. The technology holds various advantages. It will enable reduction in traffic collisions caused by human drive errors. It will relieve the driver from navigation course, thereby creating more leisure time. For the young, the elderly, people with disabilities, it will provide enhanced mobility. It ensures improved ability to manage traffic flow, combined with less need for traffic police, vehicle insurance or even road signage. There will be reduced traffic congestion and lesser parking space need. It will lead to reduction in crime related to car theft. But there is another side to it. It requires very high quality specialized map, so any out of date map would mean accident. Artificial intelligence doesn't function properly in chaotic inner city environments. Communication between cars or a car's computer can be compromised. Current road infrastructure may need changes for autonomous cars to function properly. There will be loss of driving-related jobs. Moreover, drivers in autonomous cars tend to react later when they have to intervene in critical situations compared to if they are driving manually. In India, introduction of self-driving car would mean loss of jobs of lakhs of people who are related to driving. Even the Indian city roads aren't equipped properly at present to accommodate this change. But with advancements like creating overbridges, self-driving cars can definitely run on Indian roads as well. Now let's talk about psychological autopsy. Autopsy, also called necropsy or postmortem, includes dissection and examination of a dead body and its organs and structures. It may be performed to determine the cause of death, to diagnose effects of disease, and to establish the evolution and mechanisms of disease processes. The word autopsy is derived from the Greek word autopsis, meaning the act of seeing for oneself. There are various dimensions of autopsy: medico-legal autopsy, pathological autopsy, virtual autopsy, and psychological autopsy. Medico-legal autopsy is done in Department of Forensic Medicine without the need of consent of relatives. Complete postmortem is done to find the cause of death. Pathological autopsy is done in the Department of Pathology on request from relatives. Partial autopsy of the organ or cavities suspected to be reason behind the death is done. Virtual autopsy is conducted with scanning and imaging technology by techniques such as computer tomography, magnetic resonance imaging, and 3D surface scanning. Psychological autopsy is done to classify equivocal or unclear deaths. It evolved as a method to help clarify cause of death, particularly in the estimated 20% of cases where precise mode of death is unclear. It is an investigatory tool which its proponents claim can help in the process of establishing whether an equivocal death was the result of natural cause, suicide, accident or murder. Let's see how it is done. The nature of the information collected usually includes the following: biological information like age, marital status, occupation and religious practices, personal information like relationship, lifestyle, alcohol or drug use and source of stress, secondary information like family history, police records and diaries. There are various applications of psychological autopsy, but there are ethical issues connected with it as well. There can be legal action if the informants feel their right and dignity is being hurt. The types of cases in which it is done are understanding suicides in order to develop effective services, thus reducing the rate of suicides. Understanding personality of the deceased person prior to his death. Understanding intention and motives. In criminal cases, to know if someone is to be blamed for the death or not. In life insurance, as some policies don't compensate the family of the deceased if the cause of death is determined to be suicide. In institutional care, in malpractices, allows the plaintiff to recover the damages if breach of the standard care to the patient was found to be proximate cause of suicide. Historically, psychological autopsy was thought of by Norman Louis Farberow, the father of suicidology, and Schneidman. Currently, psychological autopsy has a more productive role outside the court as the proofs required during investigation is different from what is required in the court. Now let's talk about the last topic, the Northern River Terrapin on recovery. The critically endangered Northern River Terrapin of the Sundarbans is set to get a new home, beginning a slow journey to recovery from a disastrous decline in the wild. It is more threatened than the Bengal tiger, but far less known. Before winter this year, three freshwater ponds in the Sundarbans Tiger Reserve will house the rare Northern River Terrapin or Batagur Baska, whose presence in the wild in the West Bengal and Odisha had declined to undetectable levels a decade ago. Habitat loss and clandestine harvesting had decimated the population of the species. Batagur Baska, the 60-centimeter long turtle that is presumed extinct in several Southeast Asian countries, is classified as critically endangered by the International Union for Conservation of Nature in its red list of threatened species. The tiger, by comparison, is endangered. For the past 10 years, officials of the Sundarban Tiger Reserve, with support from experts at Turtle Survival Alliance, have coordinated a recovery program for what is described as the world's second most endangered turtle through captive conservation breeding. The Yangtze giant soft-shell turtle, Raphetus swinhoei, is considered the most endangered freshwater turtle. In India, conservation breeding to save the Northern River Terrapin is ranked among the best programs. Having more sites to breed is a natural extension of the ongoing effort. The terrapin, which has a river estuarine habitat, has had a lucky spell in recent years. There was not much early success in the breeding program, but things looked up after 2012. The number of turtles at Sajnikhali is well over 200 with 87 hatchlings this year alone, while conservation had started with only 13 adult turtles. The decision to get a new enclosure for the breeding program would protect the species against natural risks and also facilitate genetic management. Last year, forest officials and the TSA reintroduced 10 turtles into the wild using acoustic transmitters to monitor their progress. This year, more may be released with satellite transmitters to determine survival and dispersal. Of the 6 large freshwater turtles of the genus Batagur, 3 are found in India. Batagur Kashuga, or the red-crowned roofed turtle, and Batagur Dhongoka, the 3-striped roofed turtle, are found in the tributaries of the Ganga such as Chambal. The Northern River Terrapin is the most endangered of the 3 species, and their long-term fortunes depend on an ecologically functional colony getting re-established in the wild. Thank you, that's all for today. Have a nice day.